Okay, I think we better get started. So yeah, thanks for joining us. And there might be a few more still joining, but today's event is the virtual field walk in Cowra, New South Wales, featuring Growave's microwave technology. Unfortunately, in these challenging times, things happened, and Liam is with Growave. He's stuck in Sydney, and Ed's on about day four of being locked down in a mandatory self-quarantine. So we're going to just have to do this the best we can. But I think we'll learn a lot. Hang in there, and we'll get through it. I should mention Ed Fagan from Olean Farms is a grower and an owner, and he has a huge amount of experience, and he's grown many, many different crops, both horticulture and broadacre. So we're lucky to have him on board. Before we get into it, the content for this event comes from the Horticulture Innovation Project VG16078, Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection Phase 2, led by AHR and RMCG. The project is funded by the Vegetable Levy with funds from the Australian government and managed by Hort Innovation. So if it depends what you're on, but you have a Q&A icon either on the bottom of your screen or on the top if you're on an iPhone type of thing. So please, as we go, just type in your questions to the Q&A box, and we'll get around to answering as many of them as we can. If we run out of time, we'll still answer them. It'll just be an email back to you. On this event, you'll stay anonymous, so don't be shy. Ask questions. All right, over to you, Liam.
Alrighty. Thanks, Mark. Now, my audio is good, just to double check before I start speaking too much. Beautiful. Alrighty. Welcome, everyone. Thanks, AHR. And unfortunately, we're not in the field. This is a shed in Sydney, and there's a very small field that we've made up of soil that we'll hopefully be able to demonstrate the machine on in a little bit. But yeah, super disappointed we can't get out on the farm and test this, you know, in a real world, solving some real problems. But my name is Liam. I'm the head of product at Growave, and we're trying to revolutionize how weeding's done through microwave technology, and really trying to be part of the electrification of agriculture as we transition over the next, you know, 10, 20 years. This project and this company has come out of a lot of research at Melbourne University over the last 7 to 8 years. And now IP Group and Artesian have invested in us to take us from the lab out into, you know, real products on the farm. And so that's kind of our job, and we're along this journey at a pretty early stage, but definitely excited to prove our technology and get out onto as many farms as possible. And so why are we doing this? We're doing this because we're seeing a lot of increase in regulation over chemical use in California and Australia. That's become harder and harder to get access to certain chemicals, and fumigants are being phased out. And so we really want to be, there's a void in the control system. We're going to come in and hopefully fill that with this new technology that allow growers to still control weeds and disease, but in a new way. And also herbicide resistant weeds. This is a huge problem across broadacre and horticulture, weeds that just aren't responsive to traditional chemical means. And so this is something that we can solve because our technology, doesn't matter what type of weed or seed it is, we can take it out. And also I think importantly, we're seeing consumers demand sustainable food, and, you know, farming practices that are more sustainable are going to become part of the next, you know, the next decade of farming production. That's something we really want to, you know, encourage and be a part of, that transition over to some of these new farming practices that are better for our soil, better for the health of the employees, you know, putting this out on the field and growing some high yield crops. And so what is our technology? So we use targeted microwave technology to take out the weed seed bank and soil pathogens before they affect the crop. And I think there's a lot of different thermal treatments coming into the market. There's flaming, there's laser. I think a real key difference of ours is that we can penetrate. And so in the case of taking out the weed seed bank, we can focus the application into the shallow part of the soil and take out the seeds before they emerge. And secondly, if we're doing pathogen control, I'll get onto this in a second, but we've been able to take out pathogens from within plants, so old strawberry plants, or within the soil, and I can share some of those results. And importantly, this is part of precision agriculture. So we really want to integrate with these technologies that we're using in terms of mapping the area and targeting this treatment, you know, because it is going to be slower and more expensive at the start, this technology, like any new technology. And that's why we really need to, take on board this precision ag where we can use cameras and different imagery to target the areas that are really, you know, have high problems. And so our technology is kind of taking the weeding approach in a new way, and that's to take out the weeds before they emerge, you know, not waiting for them to come up and do a selective spray. We really want to get a good treatment before you plant the crop and stop the weeds from growing, you know, over that early period where it's so important. And I think a really key part of this is that there's no withholding. You know, this treatment is instant. Last year, we did a trial down in Victoria on a horticulture property, and the grower could watch the machine go along, and right behind it, his oxalis had been taken out. And so that's really exciting for the grower to see that, you know, that instant turnaround in control. And also, you know, we're weather agnostic. It doesn't matter if it's windy or, you know, rainy and things like that. To some degree, you don't want to go on your field and tear it up, but we don't, those things don't come into consideration. So that's another, you know, it gives more flexibility when you're preparing the crop. But importantly, we're doing this because we really want to increase the yield of you guys growing certain crops. Hopefully this will allow you to do less field passes, going, you know, over the field once to get a really solid pre-emerge control, and you won't have to do as many emerge controls. And lastly, taking some of the risk and the cost associated with using chemicals in terms of storage and employee safety and regulation. So to date, we're early on our journey in terms of fully commercializing this technology. And you can see here, these are some of the areas where we've had some really good trials. And our biggest trial to date is within the strawberry industry. And I'll explain that one in a second. And importantly, we did some horticulture trials last year. And these are kind of proof of concept trials where we've gone out onto the farm for a specific problem on a very small area, tried the technology, and just seeing if it's worked, because that's got to help us target this. We're gonna have to target it in a few key areas so we can get good results on those, and then develop the suite out to broader horticulture. And so in terms of pathogen control within the strawberry and cotton industry, we've been able to take out Macrophemina and Fusarium. And so we're doing more trials this year to further that. But that's really exciting, especially, you know, for the cotton industry, which has, you know, some serious losses to certain pathogens. Also, we've done some leafy green pre-emergent last year, and that was trying to take out oxalis bulbs before they emerged. And that's, you know, this is a real problem weed for the grower. And lastly, kind of in the same category, is the herbicide resistant weed. We did some trials on oxalis. I'll share a few photos in a second. And we're also looking at Roundup resistant ryegrass and different weeds in that suite. So this is just a trial, just to give a bit of context, what we did last year. This was in between some lettuce rows. And this is really, really well-established nutgrass. And so we've been able to go in, apply a pretty heavy treatment, and we've been able to get, you know, control within that space for, you know, an extended period of time. And this is right next to the grower's house. So every day he'd go out and see if the nutgrass had come back. But we're really, you know, really excited to be able to get some lengthy controls. And we're going to work on this so we can start getting broader treatments. And again, I'll discuss some of the trials we're doing this year to really take this out to a larger field area. And also in terms of pathogen control, we did a really large trial last year within the strawberry industry, and this was actually a crop termination. So at the end of the year, the pathogen Macrophemina and Fusarium that spread through the soil are actually in the strawberry plant themselves. And so we were able to terminate the plant, killing the strawberry plant, but also taking out the pathogens from inside the plant. And so when they go to dig that back through the soil, when they plant the next year, there's going to be a much lower pathogen levels within the soil and spreading into the next crop. And so this is kind of like a large scale trial. There was over 3,000 plants tested, and we put them through the lab to see, you know, what pathogens grew out. So this is kind of showing that we have really good pathogen control, 90 to 95% across that area. And so our products, roadmap at the moment. In the first slide, you saw our first kind of field prototype. That was very flexible, could do a lot of things, misdesigned, you learn, it's not very targeted. This next one I'll show you when I kind of walk around the machine over here is our alpha. And this is what we have to kind of test our new applicators and test on smaller, small scale farms. And this is just to be able to do one row treating anywhere up to kind of 300 millimeters wide. And so this is just for us to test our new applicators, which is how we apply that microwave energy. And then, you know, integrate the system and we can control the speed very closely so we can start seeing how we can get faster. But from there, we've already started designing our beta system, and this will be a much bigger system, and this will be self-powered so we can go down the field and do two rows or do inter-row, anything like that. It'll be much more flexible. And this will be for a pre-emerge control or even inter-row. But in the long run, you know, we want to get to either our technology is a module that goes just behind a tractor like any other piece of equipment, or if, you know, speed or, you know, autonomy is a part of a lot of these farms, then we'll be, you know, a module that can go on the back of an autonomous platform. And so in terms of the business model for us, I think initially we'll start as a service model where we'll just pay to treat some really bad areas on farm, get some good results and build from there. But over the long run, we really want this to be, you know, a product that you guys can use and a technology that you can just put behind your tractor and go out and treat some of these problem weeds and disease. And I'd be interested to get some feedback from you guys in terms of how you see, you know, ag in the future. Is it, you know, a service model, or do you prefer owning the product and learning to understand some of this new technology? Coming to the end of this year and early next year, we've got a lot of trials to really start expanding out with this alpha unit, taking it onto the field to start doing some larger field trials. So we're doing some trials within the cotton industry and some horticulture ones in New South Wales, and we'll also do some in Victoria. And that's really targeted this pre-emerge, taking out problem weeds and seeing the effect on the soil in terms of pathogen control and then crop yield throughout. Because there is some research that Melbourne University has done that actually shows we actually get a bit of nitrogen fixing in this treatment, and they saw some increased yields. So we really want to validate some of these claims at a larger scale in the field, so we've got good data to share with growers. And then from there, we're going to get our commercial unit built next year, and that'll start doing, you know, a hectare treatment, larger scale trials like that. And so we are going to be looking for trial partners and growers that want to see this on their farm and try this technology and see how they think it works. So I've got a lot of questions for the industry, of course, understanding, you know, what are some pain points in terms of weed control? What are some main weed species that we should focus on getting good understanding of, you know, how to treat that and how much we need? Because when we see a problem, normally what we do is we get a sample and we bring it into our lab. We conduct some experiments to see the dose response or how much, you know, energy or how much time we need to treat that. And then we can take that out into the field, and we know when we go to do a field trial that we've got a good understanding of how we can control that. And so, yeah, if you guys let me know some of the problems you've got, we can start building up that kind of repertoire of dose responses for different weeds and disease. And then we know, you know, what we're really effective at controlling and what we're not. And also understanding for you guys, pathogens, you know, fumigation, is that kind of on the way out? Do are growers still fumigating a lot, and do they want to continue? And also the importance of kind of moving away from fumigants and chemicals into, you know, some more hopefully new, cleaner technology. But I think that's pretty much it for me today. We'll definitely get into a bit of a walk around this piece of equipment. I'll show you how it works. Unfortunately, again, it's not in the field, but I can still show you kind of the concept, and you can hopefully envisage this on a farm. So maybe, Mark, I'll go do a bit of a walk around. Is that next best move?
Yeah, please just stop sharing your screen. Yep. That was very good. Thanks, Liam.
Okay. All righty. Can you? Okay, can you hear me out here now?
Yeah, we can hear you good, Liam.
Oh, yeah. going to be very, you're going to have to hear them.
Yep.
Yeah, I probably won't be able to hear them. This is essentially the system here. It runs off two wheels at the front, and this allows us, these wheels can move, so we can go over any bed height. We've got a movable bed at the moment, but so we can go any row width or height we can go over. And so that can go into row or just before you plant. And so how the actual system works is, this is kind of just our power supply and our control systems in here. And then out the back, we have, this is our applicator. And so it's shielded at the moment to protect our core technology, which is the applicator. And then also for us to be able to go along the ground. So underneath there's some wheels. So as you're going down the field, like the wheels just go along nicely, keep it at the right height above the ground. And then it'll keep that a nice even treatment. And so this is the system here that generates the microwaves, and we put that straight down. And so I think that's probably it for a walk around. I don't know what else. Oh, maybe I'll touch on a few areas that may be of interest to the grower. So in terms of safety, the system has a lot of different probes around it. And these probes pick up if the microwave leakage is too high. And so, you know, at your home microwave, you have a door on it with a Faraday cage. So what we can do, we do a similar thing out here. And so if ever you go over a bump or it comes up and that energy is, you know, in the air, we have a system that will cut off and you can go again. So that's just like making sure everyone stays safe around the system, you know, because it is a new technology and we are using, you know, reasonably intense energy fields. So it's super important that we can control that side of the system. So that's often a question from growers. But no, of course, it's safe to use. We've taken it out many field trials and there's no issues with regulation or anything like that. And in terms of maybe field performance at the moment, this system will be able to go along. The applicator on there, I think, is 250 millimeters wide. And so this is either for doing multiple strips to get a pre-emergent control, or going into row to take out. But this system is not, you know, we've got to improve the design so it's a little smaller and more nimble to be able to, you know, go into row. You know, you can see this is pretty bulky. It's a bit of length, but, you know, this is our early generation. And so as we go, we'll have multiple applicators next to each other and they'll be smaller so we can cover more land. Now, I won't be able to hear.
I think they're on mute.
On mute. Oh, can you hear me still?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, I don't think we can hear
them. Okay, I've got audio now. I can hear you guys. Can you hear my previous few sentences?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's all good.
Okay. Any questions? Maybe even from some panelists on the machine itself.
Hi, Liam. I can read out the questions if you can hear me all right.
Yeah, go for it.
All right. So the first question we have is, can this technology differentiate between pathogenic and non-pathogenic species?
It's a good question. So what we do is we can map the pathogens in terms of their effect from thermal shock. And so what we do when we go along, we can give a different level of thermal shock. And so it turns out like Fusarium macrophemata is on the lower scale. So if the pathogens have a lower threshold like this, then we can't differentiate, but some of those lower ones, you know, we can take out some beneficials that are at higher, require a higher dose. But no, it's not selective necessarily in terms of which one it can treat, but we can control the technology to some degree, which allows us to target which ones we want to take out. I think importantly, I should have mentioned this technology. At the moment, we can vary our treatment depth anywhere up to kind of 6 centimeters in depth for like a deeper fumigation treatment, and that'll control pathogens. Of course, they're going to grow, you know, grow back, but that controls them for a long enough time for normally a crop. And then also we can use another type of our technology, which can go down to 20 centimeters, but that one's still early in development and the energy cost and time to treat a hectare would be much higher, but we're still kind of early days with that one.
Thanks, Liam.
Henry, it's easier to hear Liam when he's back on his computer. So maybe we can just go to Ed and then come back to the questions in a minute.
Sure, yeah. And maybe Dave can even just give a bit of a pan.
Okay, you can. All right, can you still hear my audio?
Yeah, we can hear you, Liam. So I might share my screen while Ed, we'll let Ed have the first go at maybe asking a few questions and making a few comments, and it can be a bit of a chit chat between him and Liam, and then we can get back to the questions from the attendees.
All right, have you got me, Mark?
Yep, you're on.
Okay, so a couple of questions. There's quite a few, obviously, and I know that there's questions lining up a bit. There's a few things. It looks like an electronic version of either methyl bromide or methane sodium. So thinking of that, does this control seeds that aren't respiring? So dormant seeds, hard seeds that are sitting in the soil, or do they need to be actually germinating for them to control? The main reason for that is a lot of seed, if you're doing a pre-emergent or a pre-planting pass, it's good to be able to get the plant, the weeds that are germinating, but also the ones that will germinate during the crop. Have you done any work on that yet, Liam?
Yeah, yep. So maybe I talked to Mark recently about this. Maybe not in the, maybe some horticulture species, but we've definitely done it on ryegrass and similar seeds like that in broadacre. And so, yeah, our plan, you know, as a differentiator, as a system, is to be able to take out seeds that have not started emerging at all. So yes, depending on the dose, I haven't tested every seed, you know, to know if we can, but I would assume most. Yes, we can control that. And that's the whole point of this. We want to be able to take out, not just, you know, have pre-emergence take out ones that are just starting. We want to be able to take them all out so you get that extended period of control.
Okay, and talking about pathogens, you're talking about a lot of the microorganisms. How do we go with something like Heliophis? Do you know if they'll control something larger like a Heliophis that's in the ground ready to pupate and so on or not?
To be honest, I haven't tested Heliophis. I've had a few growers ask in the last little while. So I think hopefully do you have it on your farm?
We will, yeah, in summer, absolutely.
Yeah, okay. Well, I think the best thing would be just maybe get a little bit of soil and run a test, but I would assume so. We've demonstrated good control of other pathogens. I'm not too familiar exactly like how this one behaves. But I think it's definitely just the thing. We give it a try and see how it goes. But yeah, I'd be confident.
Yeah. So, and I'll just finish off on this one. Everyone else can have a go. But at this stage, you're talking that generally speaking, you're working to 6 centimeters in depth. On this trial machine that you've got is 30 centimeters wide. When you're talking about that it's targeted, is it a bit? Does it work better right in the center and does it ease off on the outsides or is it really, really neat being 30 centimeters to 30 centimeters and the whole lot 6 centimeters through?
Yeah, great question, actually. So in some of our earlier applicators, yeah, it was like it would taper off a little bit, but we've worked pretty hard to make sure this is kind of like a blanket laser treatment. And in terms of where it ends, it's pretty sharp. We can control where it stops. And I think we're probably still need to do some development, but it's quite even across that stretch. And so, and we can actually vary that, you know, that width. So we could have multiple applicators, or if you've got narrower rows or anything like that, we can bring it down, you know, to 10, maybe even, you know, 5 centimeters in width. So that's variable. We kind of call it like a vacuum cleaner. You know, you can put different heads on it for different applications.
Okay. Thanks, Liam.
Thanks.
Hey, are you seeing my screen? Can you share my screen? You can see my screen?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I think if we were out on the farm, these are things that we would see. These are photos I took out at Mullian Farms yesterday. And these are popcorn beds pulled up. So that was kind of one of the discussions I had with Ed. Will the technology get down in the wheel tracks plus sides of the beds and on that kind of configuration?
Yeah, maybe the one we've got at the moment may struggle a little. It can tilt side to side, but somewhat limited how far we can tilt. But of course, you know, we understand, you know, there's sides of beds that are pretty steep. Last year we did some trials kind of, coming off a bed like that.
Yeah.
System worked okay on that angle, but we need to do some more mechanical stability so it can apply a little bit of force so it keeps close to that. Yeah. That's more of a mechanical issue than a tech issue.
Yeah. So I took a photo. These are cat heads. They're still dormant this time of year. They're about to come to life with some warming temps, but they're very near the surface. You would be pretty good on something like that, a hard seated cat head.
Yeah, I think so. And I think interestingly, microwave, you know, the technology itself or how it works, the larger geometry, I think will have better efficacy as well. Like because of the actual frequency, it's easier. You can imagine like if the seed's sitting there and it's easier for the actual vibrations to hit that if it's actually larger. So we've worked on small seeds, but given the size of those, that fills me with more confidence.
Yep. And you mentioned these are asparagus ferns coming up through the old ferns that grew last year through the summer and they were rolled down. So a lot of trash is a bit of a problem. Is that right?
We can go through the trash, but it'll just mean that we're kind of treating the trash almost itself, if that makes sense. You know, we want to be able to get, let's say, applicators here right below that. We want what we're trying to target. And I guess if there's a lot of trash in the way, you know, the field intensity may decrease by the time it gets to the soil or something like that. But I think if we had, you know, a decent amount of weight on a wheel, it could kind of compress that trash to some degree. Then I think we'd be able to get through that. We did do a trial with Treasury Wine Estate last year where they had a lot of trimmings, you know, from their vineyards coming on the ground. We could roll over them fine, yeah, you know, in that instance. So I think, and again, robustness, as you can imagine in agriculture, getting from the lab to someone driving along with a tractor, that's a lot of work to make sure our system, you know, is really reliable, can take the, you know, banging around on a farm.
Yeah. So this photo I'm showing now, that's not much trash. That paddock's been worked. You'd do pretty well in that.
Yeah. That'd be fine.
Yeah. What about little critters like worms and wireworms and earthworms and.
Yeah. So I guess the biology of the soil is a common question. And yeah, that's super important. So I guess, like I said before, when we can target that energy, we want to target it higher up, especially for seeds and weed control. And most of, the little bugs and, you know, worms in the soil are below that target area. We can go down to 6 centimeters, but we also can do a shallower treatment kind of in that two centimeter range. And so I think most farmers would probably want the shallower treatment potentially. And hopefully the worms don't get taken out. But I guess if you're doing a deeper treatment, it's kind of more similar to a fumigation. And of course, that's going to take out a lot of the beneficials.
Yeah. Sounds good. That softer treatment you're talking that goes faster in the real world, that's going to be also a little bit cheaper. Is that right?
Sure. Yeah. So we're working to get kind of that shallower, faster treatment.
Yeah, that's very good. I don't want to take up any more time. I think there are quite a few questions from the audience. I'll stop sharing. Ed, do you want to talk to any of these before I leave?
No, I'm fine. Thanks, Mark.
You're good.
What is it? 12:30. You'll be half an hour going through everyone's questions, I'd say.
Yep. Okay, I'll stop.
You did, by the way, take some pretty ordinary photos of some really weedy crops there, Mark. Thanks. Okay. Because that's the point of it, though, isn't it?
Okay, so back to, I'll just start at the top. We asked that question about beneficials and soil organisms, I think, that's asked quite a few times. So it doesn't differentiate between non-pathogenic and pathogenic organisms. It's like a fumigation. It's going to nuke everything in the zone that it's meant to do. Is that right, Liam?
Yeah, yeah. So I guess, should I, yeah, that Catherine from Arras and Catherine as opposed to that. Yeah, so when we target it in that area, yes, it's going to take out a lot of the beneficials, but of course they do come back. And depending on the dose we actually do, the actual recovery time can vary from, you know, a few weeks to a few months, depending on, you know, how much you really want to take that out. And so we're working on getting more and more data on the soil health. You know, Melbourne Uni, we had two PhD students looking at the longer term benefits and risks. And there isn't, you know, long-term risk to the soil, but it's more just about getting that control. And you just have to take out good and bad to be able to get that control.
Yep. There's a question about nematodes, which is pretty interesting because they're actually a little aquatic animal living in the little film of water around the soil particle. But if you're going hard, haven't
tested nematodes. A few people have asked as well, and I think they vary throughout the soil. Is that correct? At all different depths?
Yes. Yes.
And so I think, you know, the depth issue there. You know, we don't want to. It takes too much energy and time to treat really deep. And so I think that may be a harder, maybe if you wanted just a shallow treatment of that, that was effective for a little bit, but that seems a little harder to be able to treat those.
Yeah. It's a question about if you had the configuration, you could be very inter-row selective within a crop if you wanted to. Is that, you could do that design in the future type thing?
Yeah. Yeah. So we definitely, in terms of maybe, you know, the root system of the actual crop that's growing, we ran right across last year next to vineyards and, you know, the little roots come up to try and, you know, get the nutrients in the water, and there was no damage to the actual plants at all. So depending on, again, which applicator we choose, you can run pretty close to the plant itself and it won't be damaged. But you kind of imagine it's kind of like a 2D cut. So when you go down a field, you don't really want to have a heap of roots coming across low up in because you may get some damage. But yeah, it's quite targeted.
And another question, what I would expect it to take out mycorrhizae if it's in the zone. Again, it's a symbiotic, it's a fungus.
Yeah.
How heavy is it overall in regards to compaction?
Yeah, so this one just out here, I can lift it either side, you know, by hand. But we do need a power. The power source is separate to that. So, you know, if the system plugs into a PTO and you have just an alternator to get electricity out the back. And so that weighs a few hundred kilos, but I don't think it's anything significant in terms of weight, you know, a ton maybe or something, you know, or two, but I think that's pretty normal for if a tractor, you know, is a few ton driving down the field.
Yeah. Do you envision in the future, like if it could cover three beds at a time type of thing? And
For sure. Yeah. If we nail one bed, nothing stopping us from, you know, expanding that out. I'd probably say to that, you know, the wider you want to go and the faster you want to go, you know, the more power you're going to need. So, you know, it's going to be finding that balance between kind of power and time and how fast, you know, growers want to travel versus, you know, some of the power requirements for the tractor.
And you mentioned you needed 50 horsepower to just do it one bed at a time.
Well, no, you could probably do a few beds. 50, this system here only uses 5 or 10 horsepower or like very, very small amount. And so I think when we build this up, yeah, 100 horsepower tractor will be fine.
Okay. So that's, I think that answers the question. How much PTO power is needed to drive the generator? Horsepower, yeah. Treated.
So this one here is only 10 kilowatts, a little less off the back end, but again, we can vary that. But I'm probably thinking probably around 40 or 50 kilowatts kind of off the back end. So yeah. 100 horsepower is well within range.
Would this technology have the capacity to kill potato tubers post-harvest? So you got the volunteers that are a problem.
Yeah, for sure. I'd say it would do extremely well at that. It's a high moisture relative to the other area, so it'll actually, the energy will target into that potato. And yeah, I think it's like when you put your potatoes in your microwave at home, I don't think they grow after that. Probably. I haven't done that experiment, but I'm assuming might even cook them. Yeah.
Yep. No, very good. You mentioned nitrogen fixing. So there's a good question. Do we know if microwave has any impact on soil nutrient availability?
Yeah, so I want to have broader data before I, you know, make claims or things like that. But some early research, and it's been done multiple places around the world, in Japan and things like that, show, you know, there is actually, you know, an uptake in nitrogen, you know, available to the plant. So some people have read some papers and have requested us come do this purely for the yield growth, not the weed control. But again, when we get broader treatment and we can, you know, get really good soil data, then we'll know, you know, what is that. So I don't want to say there's any benefit at the moment. Let's just say neutral. Yeah. And that could be a benefit longer term.
So what range of power consumption, like kilowatts per hour per hectare, are you achieving at the moment between the low and high thermal shock use cases? Somebody knows their stuff.
Good question. That's what I work on all the time. So hard question to answer, because it does vary on the low, like the soil and how much thermal shock is required. I may have a number. I may get back to that. I'll have to just look at a spreadsheet to see kind of what we're at the moment.
Yeah, no problem. How much diesel does it use per square meter with this size unit?
Diesel per square meter. Okay.
Or per diesel per hectare, whatever. It's just an idea.
Yeah. So I've got some numbers here. So looking at around 1,000 to 3,000 kilowatt hours per hectare, if that makes sense at the moment. And then you can take that down to, I don't have it per square meter, but roughly going on, I did 24 like kind of cents per kilowatt from diesel, and that's kind of looking anywhere from like a few hundred up to, you know, what, up to well over 1,000. 1,200 is kind of our max diesel cost. But of course, that's something we're going to bring down. You know, we understand we've got to be cost competitive, and our only input is, you know, energy or diesel. And so, you know, we will bring that down. So, you know, yeah, just to surmise, probably anywhere from 1,200 to 3,000 kilowatt hours per hectare.
Yeah. Hey guys, is this an Aussie technology?
It is. Yeah. From Melbourne University. I'm in Sydney. We've got fabricators and people working in Melbourne, Sydney, everything like that. So 100% Australian.
That is fantastic. How important is soil type, such as clay versus sand? How does that affect things?
Yeah, fair question. And so we haven't run trials on every soil type, but we have good data kind of from sandy loam all the way through to reasonably heavy clay. And because we're only targeting that shallow area, the soil type will affect how far we can penetrate. But again, it's kind of like within that range, we can control our end. And then, you know, with the soil, we can actually tune the system to some degree. And so we have a tuner that can couple into the right soil type. But some of the heavier soils, you know, will require a little more energy, you know, because it's just higher density, essentially. Some of the sandier ones, it can penetrate a little deeper, but most horticulture soil is pretty nice and rich. So
soil temperature and moisture, the moisture is probably a bigger factor than texture. Is that a fair statement?
Mm-hmm. For sure. Yep.
Yep. And temperature is really not irrelevant.
Yeah, no, that doesn't really matter.
Yeah. If you go out in the middle of winter and you go out on frosty ground, you just thaw it out, no?
Yeah.
Okay. If the leaf area of a nutgrass plant is treated, is there any capacity for the waves to travel down to the nut if it's below the treatment depth to kill the nut? Maybe a bit systemic or something.
Yeah, that's the really hard thing to control nutgrass and oxalis, is because you're working up the soil, the nuts just get spread throughout the whole profile. And so what we want to do is just be able to take it out from that top section. We could, but it would be very extremely slow and expensive to take it, you know, through the whole profile of however deep you're, you know, rotary hoeing. We have had growers have these problems in a greenhouse, and he sifted the soil with an excavator. So I guess if that's the cost comparison, I think would be competitive there. But to take it out from the whole soil, I think is pretty hard. But if we can take it out from a solid top section, you can get the crop should be able to get up and get away. And then maybe if there's lower tillage or less depth disturbance over time, you can bring that nut, the nuts per square meter or whatever the unit is down. So you're getting some lower effect from nutgrass.
Yeah. Do you have a commercial partner to manufacture and go to market? I think the question behind this question is sometimes these things stay in research and really innovative things don't get out to the commercial world very quick. So is that?
Fair question. So yes, we got investment from the private market to get this to market. But in terms of manufacturer and scalability, 100%. So we've started looking at some partnerships with some larger OEMs in the country, and we're developing some relationships on the module part. We're probably not quite at the point where we've got our design to give to someone or partner with someone and say, hey, let's make 10,000 of these or something like that. But we're very aware that we're not going to be, a sole manufacturer. Our business is technology and how to integrate that. It's not in manufacturing. So we'll definitely partner with a large manufacturer when the time comes. But we're probably just a little early on for that. We've started those early discussions.
Yeah. That is very good. I think I've answered questions.
Yeah, maybe just a quick one on Hugh. Is the power source from a tractor? Yeah, so this system can run just from the PTO. So super simple to integrate. And so some of our next ones might be self-powered. We'll just have a diesel generator on board. That's just so we can control everything on our end. But yeah, we want to get it so it just goes behind a tractor. Doesn't get much simpler.
There are three more questions in the chat, if you can see those, Mark.
I'm looking there and I can't see anything that hasn't already been asked though.
Maybe the height one. Yeah. So this system will go along and we can adjust that fine. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Very good.
Some questions to the growers, I guess. What are some real problem weeds or pathogens that they're maybe struggling to control with traditional chemical, controls, or what are some things where they see this could potentially be, quite useful?
I think we need Ed.
We need Ed. Ed.
You need me for this one, do you, Mark?
Yeah, please.
Oh, God, every weed.
yeah.
Nutgrass is a big one. And I think, particularly in horticulture, nutgrass is a big one. Getting away from horticulture in a broadacre sense, you'd have to think things like wild radish and resistant ryegrass are a very big one.
Yeah.
The other thing is if you look at crops that are, around the world have Roundup Ready technology, a lot of the chemical companies then start pulling the selective herbicides that are registered for those crops get pulled back because of lack of demand. We're seeing that right now with beetroot because the biggest herbicide user for beets is sugar beet, which is all now Roundup Ready. So there's no selective herbicides used there anymore, which is putting strain on what we have in our toolkit for beetroot, for instance. Every crop's different. If you look at the baby leaf business, every weed is a problem in baby leaf. There's no such thing as a good one. That could be more simple to work with than some of the other crops because it's such a short crop. You've just got to take out everything that's in the top 6 centimeters, you'd be right. Now, one thing that wasn't asked is how fast does this thing actually pass across the ground? How many hectares an hour or hectares a day would one unit do?
Yeah, good question. So at the moment it's super slow because this is a small unit and it's our first one. And so at the moment we're kind of at 0.3, kind of 0.3 to 0.2 kilometers an hour. And that's with one applicator. So of course we can stack that out. And then if we increase the power, we can go faster. And so that's a good point about this technology, is it is going to be hard. If we're trying to do really big, large blanket treatments, it is going to take longer and cost more. But especially, I think, if we target on the problem areas, or maybe just, you know, where the crop's going to be planted or something like that, where it's more precision, I think, you know, the less area you have to treat, the faster and the cheaper it'll be in terms of a cost. But we're fully aware that we have to get to a speed that, you know, is a standard for the ag industry. And we're working pretty hard. That's one of our main goal, is to increase speed. And that comes through, you know, getting a more efficient applicator and the whole system in itself, getting more energy efficiency so we can get that where it needs to go. But time per hectare is, because it's so small, we've never treated a hectare. But as soon as we build this next, the pre-commercial unit, that'll be a hectare, and we can see how long. But it'll be multiple hours per hectare for sure at the moment.
Are you seeing some of the answers back to you on the problem weeds too? Are you seeing that, Liam? Stinging nettle in lettuce and spinach, fleabane, Johnson's grass and sweet corn. I think those are just answers to your question.
Yeah, great. Okay. I'll take note of those and see if we can.
There's a question on sclerotinia, which is that is a bad soil-borne disease. Lasts for like 8 years. Do you got any?
Okay.
Any info on sclero? Probably not yet.
Yeah. Oh, and maybe quickly, is there any fire risk? No, not really. It's like we've got a lot of safety systems in place for that. Not really of concern, especially in horticulture, everything so green and moist. You know, maybe if there was some really dry, you know, like how maybe some of the more of the stubble things, if there was some intensity around a point, maybe some, you know, metal or something that would create like in a little intense field. But we've done a fair bit of field work and haven't had any fires to date.
Yeah. So question, have you tried this on algae? If not, do you think it would work? I guess they're trying to kill algae on the soil surface.
On the surface. Yeah. Interesting. No, I haven't tried on algae, but
I would think it would
find some algae. Yeah. I think it would. Yeah.
It'd be pretty deadly. So how deep can it go, and does the extra depth cost more power money, which I think.
Yes, it does. Yeah.
Do you have any idea of the cost of a 30 centimeter wide unit to buy something outright? Are you to that point yet?
We're not to the point where, you know, I can say a number now, but it'll probably scare people, but that's a prototype cost. But I see it being kind of, for probably, let's say a 1 to 2 meter width, you know, maybe one bed or two beds, the cost, especially if it's powered by a tractor, I don't see it more kind of like within the $50,000 to $100,000 range. So nothing, you know, most of this stuff at scale we can get for quite, you know, is quite cost effective. But at the moment, you know, the machines take a lot of time and a lot of niche parts, so it's more expensive. But, and we know it's got to be cost effective for the grower. You know, that's where we're trying to be a successful business, you know.
Yep.
Just a great idea.
Okay. I think we've covered on. I had just one, I got a question. Just, you did a bit of work down in Victoria with RMCG, and you've been making some improvements. Like what improvements are you working on, like now and going forward?
Yes. So we did the trial there last year to take out like nutgrass and diseases on a farm down there. The applicator itself was kind of like, we almost had to like manually hold it in the right line. And so now we've got this whole system here that can go at any speed, and you put it on a row and you can just set it to go. You know what I mean? And so this one's much more robust. We had different connections, a little hard to explain, but last year we had some cabling to run power. That caused just a few issues. So we're kind of, this system's more robust, it's more accurate. And like Ed asked before, when we're getting in more even treatment across the row, if that makes sense. So last year we had kind of that slight fate, like dying out. This is much, much more targeted and more energy efficient is a huge part. So we're trying to scale up that. And so this one, you know, really we can start hopefully doing some longer beds, whereas last year was kind of a little small and dinky, you know, if I'm honest. we'll be able to do bigger treatments?
Well, I think we've worked through the questions and I think we'll wrap it up. That was just really excellent. You got any comments or questions, Ed? Last chance?
No, I think most of the things I was thinking about are covered. I just, you are still coming up here, aren't you, Liam?
Yeah, I was going to say to everyone who's listening in, yeah, we'll definitely take some videos when we're in the field and we'll get some before and after photos of some nutgrass and some different weeds. So we can, you know, even though we weren't in the field today, we will be, I'm hoping, pretty soon. And then, yeah, we'll definitely capture a lot of that and get that out to everyone, you know, involved in this. So, yeah, thanks everyone for joining today.
That'd be great. Questions. Thank you.
All right. I'll give a big thanks to Liam and Ed for their time and participating in an excellent discussion on microwave technology. This meeting has been recorded and we will send a link to the recording to everyone who has registered. And other resources are to be found on the project website, soilwealth.com.au. The Hort Innovation Projects VG 16078 and Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection Phase 2 is funded by Veggie Levy with funds from the Australian government and managed by Hort Innovation. All right, thanks for joining us and have a good day.
Yeah, thanks everyone.